Okay. So today we'll have a very basic introduction of what CP3 is, what is the process of the entire examination, both from IFO and IEI perspective, and we'll understand how to move forward with CP3 subject. Before starting on, I will just explain or maybe just give you a head start that generally passing percentage for CP3 in case of IFOA, it's around 45 to 50% is the passing rate. Last time, talking about April 2021, the result was somewhere around, I think, 720 students cleared out of, I think, 1,300 approximately students who appeared. So it's approximately 45 to 50% for IFOA. For IEI, obviously, it's a little lower. Somewhere around 20% is the passing, 20 to 30%. So that is for IEI. There are also a little bit of differences between IEI and IFOA, not much of a difference in the paper pattern as such. Both exams are of 3 hours for both IFOA and IEI. Just that we get a scenario material, which I'll discuss now, and what is the main difference, which we'll discuss. As such, the passing percentage, obviously, for IEI is a little lower than that of IFOA. And generally, we've seen generally that students generally fail to clear CP3 with just 2 to 5 marks of marks band. Like they just skip passing because of maybe 2 to 5 marks. So that is generally what we have seen over time with students who appear both from IFOA and even in case of IEI. Right? So I will just talk about the basic structure of CP3 paper, how it is, how to move forward with it. I'll just share a PPT with you all. So I hope my screen is visible. Just give me a thumbs up. Okay, great. Thank you. So CP3, as the paper name suggests, communication practice. So it's basically communicating what you have studied or what you have been practicing in these years, what you have studied in your core in your CM and CS papers. So it's basically putting on everything together so that a layman can understand what you are trying to explain, right? So it's a communication practice. So the paper pattern is that in exam duration is of 3 hours, both for IEI and IFOA. I think they are actually now introducing, in case of IEI, 5 minutes download time, I think, which they'll announce somewhere soon. Also, in case of IFOA, they give you 15 minutes extra time for uploading the paper, which is 3 hours just for writing, and then an extra 15 minutes for uploading the paper in case of IFOA. In case of IFOA, the exam duration maybe of 3 hours or 3 hours 15 minutes, again, that depends, right? So the main so you can just consider it to be of a 3 hours exam. Here the time never falls short. Like you will never have time crunch in your exam, in a CP3 exam, by you just get 2 questions basically. First question is of 90 marks, which is the major question in which we write the entire communication. We present all our viewpoints and whatever we have to convey. And then the second question is of 10 marks. So that consists of basically 2 to 3 questions, maybe of 5 marks, 4 marks, and 1 mark, so on, 2 marks, 4 marks, and 4 marks. It depends how it goes. So the second question is of 10 marks, which is actually known as reflective questions. What are these reflective questions? It is basically reflecting on what you have written in your first question. So what you have understood, what you have written in your first question, that you have to explain in the second question, right? So it's 90 plus 10. So 90 marks question, you can approximately you have to write not more than 900 words. You don't have to write more than 900 words in case of your 90 marks question. So when I say mo not more than 90 marks, not more than 900 words, so it approximately comes down to 2.5 pages, right? So in your Word document, and to writing 2.5 pages in Word document is not that big deal. And talking about the 10 mark question, again, it's maybe approximately 1.5 to 2 pages maximum. So entire Word document will be of approximately 5 to 6 pages. So in terms of, number of words, in terms of the length of the paper is not that great, But here the main thing is thinking process. What you have to communicate, you have to think first, and then you have to produce it in your paper. So that is, that particular portion takes most of the time, basically. Okay. So you have to study the material, make notes. As such, you don't have to actually study any material. You just have to practice a lot of papers, and you do not have to research on any given topic. So in case of IFOA, what happens? You get the study material or the scenario material, which we call advanced scenario material, 3 days prior, 3 working days prior to your examination. And in case of IEI, the only difference is in case of IEI, you get it on the very same time as your exam starts. You get the scenario material at that very moment. So there is an advantage in case of IFOA because you get that 3 extra days to read the scenario, to understand, to make your own notes, to check the jargons. And but you don't have to carry out any extra research on that scenario which is given to you. That is not what they are expecting. In case of IFOA, IEI, yes, you get the scenario material on the very same day. So that is one drawback in case of IEI, which we can say. In case of IFOA, that's an advantage which we get, right? So basic objectives of CP3, I'm not going to read through these points. Yes, Kriti.
Is it given on the same day of the exam or like with the question paper?
With the question paper. So if your exam is starting from 2 p.m., it will be given at 2 p.m. Exam paper and the scenario material.
Okay, thank you.
So you have 3 hours in case of IEI to read the scenario material, understand the scenario material, then read the actual question, and then solve it. In case of IFOA, you get it 3 days prior, the scenario material. So you have 3 days to read the scenario material, to understand, to make your own notes, and to draw graphs if you want to in your Excel. So all that is in case of IFOA. In case of IEI, that is one, you can say, thing which is not there, right? That advantage is missing in case of IEI. So basically, we'll move from scratch. We'll move one by one, step by step. Firstly, objectives. So the main, I'm not going to read through all of these points. So basically, the objective of CP3 examination is to communicate. So you have to communicate in a very layman terms. And when I say in a layman terms, it does not mean that you use very kiddish words. No, you have to write the paper to the point. And so that whoever is your audience can be the shareholder of your company. It can be a policy holder or a consumer of your company. It can be a new intern or a new employee who is joining the company. It can be a new manager, a new product manager maybe who is joining your company, or it can be your business partner. It can be anyone, right? It can be, let's say, talk about trustees of your company. So it can be a finance, even it can be a finance head of your company. So it depends on who the audience is. Your communication will depend in that particular manner. So if you can't compare a policy holder with a employee, new employee who is joining your company, or maybe a new actuarial intern who is joining your company. So you can't compare them. You can't compare the level of knowledge of trustees with that of a new product manager who is joining. So in that way, our communication will change, right? And in all the papers, past papers which we have, they have tested more or less in case of IFOA, they have tested these 5 to 6 audiences only: policy holder, trustees, new member, new employee joining your company, or a new manager, product manager, be it marketing manager, whatever, joining a company, or a business partner. So these 5, 6 audiences they have majorly talked upon, right? So this is the basic objective of CP3. To present everything in a very simple, crisp, and good manner so that it's understood by the audience, right? Let's talk about few things, few very intricacies, details before moving on, and then obviously in the coming classes we'll be solving and we'll be discussing a lot of papers. So the structure of the sentence, the structure of the sentences, it should not be very impersonal, or it should not use a lot of passive sentence. Like I've taken an example. It was agreed by the board that the offices would be sold. Instead of writing this big sentence, you can just straight away write the board members agreed to sell the offices. So it's a very active form of expression. Do not use words like I, You can use words like we, definitely. You can use, so do not talk in passive terms, always talk in terms of active terms, right? That is what they expect you to do. Do not exaggerate, do not elongate your sentences unnecessarily. Keep it short, crisp, and to the point. So you can understand the difference, passive and active. Jahan pe, we say that it was agreed by the board. Instead of that, instead of writing so much, just write board members agreed to sell the office. These small things are very important in CP3 papers, and we generally lose marks here in the sentence construction. That is very important. Cut the waffle, as I said, that do not exaggerate. If you wouldn't say it, don't write it. Like, do not exaggerate what you have to say. Just keep it to the point. Like, I've written two examples over here. Most middle and senior managers in the retail service sector are given company cars. This simple one line is written, this same thing is written over here in the first point, but you can see the length of the sentence. Keep the length of the sentence short, and generally IFOA suggests that the length of the sentence should not be more than 20 words. That is approximate. You can obviously go to 20 to 25 words or 15 to 20 words. That is it. But do not cross, do not write a sentence which contains, you know, two to three things together. One sentence should talk about one idea. It should not talk about more than one thing in one particular sentence. Okay, so that is what they talk. And even there is marks given on the sentence length, sentence construction, which we'll come to in the end, right? Save time and use short addresses. So basically the entire format, there is an entire format of your communication. So communication can be in the form of an email, memo, it can be a letter, or you are maybe writing a article, right? Or it can be something which came last year in April 2020, which was print press. You have to write something for the print for the press. So press release, basically. So all of these 6-7 things are there. I'll give you the formats, no problem in that. But make sure in all the formats, you don't have to actually memorize as such something differently. Almost all the formats contain a few similar things. Like, there should be a company letterhead, including the address. So if you are writing from a point of view of a company, so it's always a company letterhead and the address should be there. If you are just a sole consultant who is writing, then your name and your own address, or your name of your consultancy and the name of your address, that should be there. And the one who you are communicating to, suppose you are communicating to a policy holder, so the address of the policy holder. Basically, what do I mean is, in the question, you will not directly get the addresses of your company, of the policy holder's company, or the exact date when you're writing the communication. So they expect you can just write company letterhead, including address. You can just write the policy name of the policy holder, whoever it is, Mr. Turner's address. And instead of writing today's date, you can just write date. So they will see that you know the format and they'll give you the full marks. You don't have to make up your own address. Don't do that. Don't make up your own address. It takes a lot of time. Why to do that? Just write company's address, policyholder's address, and date. That's done. You don't have to write extra information. Make your own information. Don't do that. And if obviously company's name is given, you will write the name of the company also. And policyholder's name is given, you will write the name of the policyholder. So we'll come to that. Again, this contains 3 marks. So all of these 3 marks, 2 marks, 1 mark makes up your, helps you to pass the exam, right? Now, actuarial language. So not everything is considered to be acceptable or familiar with that of the recipient or with that of the audience. So suppose if you just, basically one thing which we use while writing the paper is that, do you know this word before starting your actuarial journey? Just try to recollect that, whether would you be knowing this particular word before starting your actuarial journey. So suppose we talk about profit margin in case of an insurance company. What's a profit margin? You directly cannot use the word profit margin for a policy holder. That person will not understand. So what you can do is, you can simply write premium divided by you can just simply write profit divided by premium, and then you can explain what is profit in terms of an actuarial company. You can just simply write premium minus or premium less the claims paid. So in that simply two lines, you are explaining what a profit margin is. You have to understand that prior to starting your actuarial journey, would you be able to understand that particular word? And there are many other words like variance. Some simple policyholder might not understand what is variance, what is volatility, right? Yes, Arpit.
Can we explain profit margin, like the percentage of profit included in the premium, excluding the claim expenses, like this?
So basically, it will again depend upon the audience. If the audience has a good financial knowledge, then you can use this, no doubt. But if it is given that you are communicating to a policyholder and you do not know the level of knowledge of that policyholder can be again very well educated, or that policyholder can be very well educated, or maybe that policyholder may not be having that much level of finance knowledge. So you have to play safe. You cannot use so much of jargons again while explaining another jargon, right? So you have to basically play safe. And when we talk about, suppose we have a new product manager, and maybe one single line is given that that particular manager, that she was heading some pharmaceutical company, for example. So again, if she was heading some pharmaceutical company, she might not be able to understand actuarial jargons, right? So this will be given to you. One single line, if this is given, you will understand that person's level of finance knowledge or the actuarial knowledge. And if it is only given a trustee or if it is only given a policyholder, then you are obviously not aware of the financial back of the education background of that knowledge background of that person. And when we say group of trustees, so generally you get this question also that you are communicating to a group of trustees. So again, a group of trustees can comprise of people who are very, very well averse with these accounting, financial concepts and everything, words, jargons. There may be some trustees who might not at all be knowing about these things. So you have to keep your, again, content as such. All the trustees can understand. You are not actually, focusing on some of the trustees, then that is actually leading to a ba very bad tone of your entire communication. Actually, this thing is very, very, very important and becomes very, very difficult in CP3 exams, that what to write. Even if we, how to write, basically, even if we know what do we want to write, what do we want to communicate, but how to write, that is a very important task here. The main is how to write. How to communicate, even if you know the points, but you're not able to communicate properly. And what do you do? End up doing in the exam? You end up writing one simple thing, explaining one simple thing in, more than three, four lines, which is not required. You're actually exceeding the word limit. This is one thing which generally happens when you. So here, when we'll come to the end, towards the end of the discussion, you will understand you can never score 100% marks in the content. Like, it's a very subjective paper. You will never score 100% marks in your content. IFOA or IEI's model solution and your solution, the content will never match. There will be differences in points. But where you can score your marks, these small, small things. Do not write long sentences. Do not use jargons. All of these small, small things are the places where we can score marks in CP3 and actually pass the paper. Right. So, okay, approach to producing written communication. So these are a few points which I have written. So do use the terms which the recipient can follow. Are you meeting the recipient's requirements? So basically, in the entire paper, mark this. This is very, very important for CP3. There are no more than two to three objectives, in the sense, not more than two to three topics which you have to communicate. So when you read your question paper, you have to. So first, you will get the scenario material that consists of maybe 6 to 7 pages. Basic scenario will be given, and a lot of content will be given in that 6 to 7 pages of PDF. Then the question will be asked, and again in the question, some other information will be given to you, maybe 1 or 2 pages of information again, and then the final question. So you have so much of information that you end up writing. You will think that let's include this as well, that let's include this as well, and you end up writing almost everything, which is where you start losing your marks. So main, when we'll do this in the class, when you read the question, try to take out two to three or max to max 4 points major points which the recipient is asking for. And there will never be more than three to four these objectives which recipient is asking for. And then you have to search for that what you actually have to write for these 3 to 4 objectives. Take up that information, simplify it, and then write it in your paper. You do not have to include so much of content and everything. That is, so one of the major thing over here is to screen the data, screen out the data which you do not need, screen out the information which you do not need, and only take out that information which you actually need to communicate. So that is, again, a very, very important factor. If you are able to find out 3 to 4 objectives, you have actually saved half of your time in order to understand what information you have to write. Trust me, this actually helps a lot during the examination, right? How emotional your communication is, it should not be emotional at all. It should be very neutral. If you are communicating any bad news, maybe to a policyholder or maybe to a trustee or to your client, you have to keep it very neutral. You don't have to apologize so much so that you are putting yourself in a bad light. You have to keep very neutral. You have to apologize, but at the same time, you have to explain your error, and you have to mention that we have, you know, clarified these errors and we'll not do this in future. So you have to keep it very balanced. You don't have to apologize. There should be no emotional quotient in your entire paper. It should be very balanced. So if a new employee is joining in, you can just write one line that we welcome you to our company. I welcome you to our company. So this you can obviously write. So it's a friendly approach, but at the same time, keep it very formal. Okay. So this is there. Then these are, let's just skip it. Making the point accurately. So here I've taken an example. Equities are better investment than gilts. Suppose if you have to explain this to your trustee, your trustees actually want to invest in gilts, but you being the consultant, you being the financial consultant over here, you want to explain to them why equity is better. So in that case, you can't straight away just blatantly write this particular line. So there are two things. If suppose your policyholder thinks that the premium which you are charging is very high as compared to other companies, but you are correct, actually you have correctly priced your product, so you have to explain that why you have done it, why the premium is higher. You cannot straight away start by writing, no, you are wrong, premium is correct, and all of that. You cannot write the bad news in the beginning. You first have to explain the entire thing. What is the process? And then at the end, you will have to mention that according as per our calculations, our pricing is absolutely correct. So that is what you have to give at the very end. So when you have to communicate any bad news, or maybe for the audience, or maybe any news which audience is not expecting, you have to first explain it. And then at the end, you give the final conclusion. Yes.
I have a question related to the example which you have given on premiums. So when we are trying to explain the policyholder where he went wrong or what the actual premium is, will there be any sensitive information which we can share in our script? Like if there is any sensitive information given to us, like whether we have to filter out and say it to the policyholder, how we can manage this scenario?
Correct. So this was my second point, actually. So you have to actually understand to whom you're communicating. Suppose there is one point mentioned that if the profits are higher, if we are able to maintain an actual level of the given level of profit, then only we can, you know, provide the bonuses. This thing you cannot communicate to a policyholder directly, but to a trustee of your company, you know, to a manager of your company, you can directly communicate this because it's from company's point of view. So it's good for your company, but you cannot communicate any sensitive information or these kind of information directly to the reader. So that is when you have to actually filter out the data, right? Very good question. So here I've taken the insurance company looks at its profits and works out how much money to pay as a bonus to your contract. So basically, first we look at our own. So here, if you communicate this particular line to the policyholder, it might seem a little selfish on your part, although you are correct where you are standing. But from the policyholder's point of view, you look selfish. Your company looks selfish, right? Obviously. If we talk about, we are standing in the policyholder's shoes. But if we just write it, we reframe it and we write it, the value of your savings may increase by a bonus, which will depend on company's profit. So here, this looks good, that if we make profit, if you're able to make profit, then your savings, your value of savings will increase by the amount of bonus which we provide you. So a very good question. And this actually is the case when you communicate. And generally, it is seen, so the communication to the policyholder, this you will get in a lot of papers, because they actually want to see how you can explain the jargons, because a policyholder will not understand any jargon, any actuarial jargon, right? Or how to filter out these sensitive information, how to write these. When you are pricing your product, you are charging differently to a female, to a male. How to explain that to a female policyholder, to a male policyholder, why you are charging extra premium. That is where you cannot directly say to a male policyholder, because the mortality rates of your mortality rate is higher. You cannot directly say this. And when you are, suppose, talking about a person who is maybe a little overweight, so, and maybe he or she is a smoker, so you cannot directly say that you are overweight, your BMI index is this much, and so that is why we are charging you extra premium. That you cannot directly say. So these are the places where you have to actually, you know, reframe your sentences so that it looks good and straight, and also communicating your viewpoint, right? So this will again come with practice. It is very important in CP3 paper that you write the first question, the 90 marks question. At least you practice 10 papers, you know, you write, sit down and write those 10 papers minimum, so that you can understand where, you know, you are going wrong. And if you don't actually sit down and write, you will never get into the habit of writing. And during an exam, it will actually, you're not able to write during your exam as well. So that is one major thing which happens in CP3. Okay, style and tone, which I've already discussed. When you're communicating any bad news, make sure you first explain everything and then at the end you communicate. Mortality rates are not as high as you suggest. Suppose someone who is suggest. So it's basically you're communicating a negative news. It might not be negative from your viewpoint, but it might be negative from the trustees, from maybe your company is facing little losses. But that is not due to your investment strategy. That is all in all because of the market condition. Every company is facing that particular situation. But that is that thing the trustee will not understand unless and until you explain it in a better way, right? So that is how your style, tone, viewpoint comes in. These are a few examples of the second question, reflective question. Those 10 marks are actually a gift. And trust me, everything, there are around 9 to 10 type of questions which can come in that second mark question. I have actually made the entire list for you all, wherein I have put in, so suppose the question is, what all terminologies or jargons have you excluded? And what all jargons have you included? Explain why. So this can be a question in your 10 mark question. One of the question can be this, maybe of 2 marks or 3 marks. Then there is a question, what style and tone you maintained while communicating this particular news? Or what all points you deliberately excluded from your scenario, from your communication, which you otherwise would have added if you had communicated to someone else, right? These questions, what graphs, what numericals you have used, why you have used them. And all of these, in case of IFOA and IA, you just cannot type in anything. You have to use some keywords. They check these keywords and give you marks. So that is very important. You cannot take that 10 marks question very lightly, because if you score actually 7 to 8 marks in that 10 mark question, so it's a gift to you. And generally I've seen people taking that 10 mark question very lightly, and they end up scoring 3 to 4 marks only out of 10, wherein you can easily score 7 to 8 marks. So even 4 marks, 2 marks are very helpful in case of CP3. So I will give you the entire list. You don't have to worry. I'll give you the entire Word document which I have prepared, wherein you can, you know, get that keywords which you have to mention. And obviously, when you practice papers, you will get accustomed to those keywords, right? We'll also discuss that in class, so that's not an issue. visual aids. So again, in your let me just skip this bit. We'll discuss it in classes. Then this is the entire marking pattern, and this is actually something which you have to, you know, keep in mind while answering, because this is where you will pass, considering this small thing. So let's talk about everything in detail. Proper range of words. So what if in the question, in the 90 mark question, it is given that write within 850 words. You have to keep it till 850 words only. If you exceed, you will lose 1 mark, 2 mark, and so on. It depends. So if you exceed, if you write up to 900 words, you will lose 1 mark. If you extend that, you will lose again a 2 mark. So it should be within word limit, and 5 marks will be there. If word limit is not mentioned in your paper, keep it in the range. Do not cross 900 words, right? Do not cross 900 words, more than 900 words, if there is no word limit given to you. Then, okay, and one more thing, the word limit, the count of word limit starts from the main text. So in the initial, when you are writing company address, policy holder's address, date, all of those are not considered. The moment you start the actual communication, from that point till the very end, excluding the salutation, your word limit will be considered, right? So the salutation, final salutation, and the company letterhead, company address, all of those will not be counted in the word limit, in the word count. So that is here 5 marks. Straight shot, 5 marks will be given to you. And if you are thinking that this is very simple, I can be in the word limit, it's actually not simple. If it's 900 words, you cannot just simply write 600 words and expect that you will get the 500. You will get 500 marks. It should be actually somewhere between 850 to 900, or somewhere in this particular range at least. Because they are expecting you to write that much. You cannot keep it 600. Or you cannot, you know, keep it in 1,000 or 1,200 words. That you cannot do. And actually, when you sit and write, it might so happen generally 90% of the times you're exceeding word limit. So you will again go back and have to delete a few sentences. This again generally happens with all of us. Firstly. Secondly, letter is properly addressed. Suitable title is there. You have communicating to the policy holder, then the title, whatever it is. Address and date. This gives you 3 marks. So again, a gift. This 8 marks are complete gift to you. Given. Like full sure shot, you will get this 8 marks. Then planning and presentation, very, 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 very important section, grouping of ideas. So within your communication, we'll be writing 3 to 5 paragraphs. It should not exceed more than 5, or it should not be even less than 3 paragraphs. It should be 3 to 5 paragraphs. So as I said, that there are not more than 3 to 4 objectives. Each objective the client is asking for, the audience is asking for, is explained in one section. So 3 to 5 sections only. Maybe the 5th section is the summary, or maybe it is introduction, whatever it is, but not more than 3 to 5 sections. You'll get sure shot 2 marks. Then we have logical order of points. This is again very important, but we generally do not get full 6. We generally get 4 marks, or maybe 5 if you're very good, or 3 to 4 marks or 5 marks generally in this particular place. Logical order of points, you cannot just explain. You have to flow. You have to maintain the flow of your communication. And you cannot explain something, or you cannot just write any particular word or any particular thing which you haven't explained. So it should be properly flowing. The points should be in a logical order, right? So again, 6 marks. Generally, I've seen we never get full 6 on 6 here. Here we can straight away get 5 on 5, 3 on 3, 2 on 2. 6 on 6 is very difficult to get. Generally, the maximum limit you get is till 5 or 4. Appropriate short headings. So each section, the heading of each section should be short, not more than 5 words. That is also maximum, which I'm saying. It should be approximately to 3 to 4 to 5 words, not more than that. Keep it very short. And also that heading which you are giving for each section should be a valid heading. It cannot be just any vague heading which you have written. It should be something which is reflective of your entire paragraph. So we talk about 2 things over here. One is signposting, forward signposting and backward signposting. What are this? Suppose I'm writing that how the products are priced. I have explained this in the section below. This is known as forward signposting. So you are telling the user, you are explaining the audience that this particular thing, this particular communication is coming up in my next section. Okay, forward signposting. What is backward signposting? You are at the end, maybe you are writing. So this thing has been explained in the above section. That is backward signposting. Here again, this you get marks on this these particular things. Sentences should be kept brief. Here again, with the thing which I mentioned, it should not be more than 20 words, max to max, 20 to 25 words, not more than that. It should be very brief, crisp. This entire thing gives you 12 marks. Generally, again, here I've seen students getting maximum of 9 to 10 marks, right? That is maximum which you can score here. Charts. So the entire, in your entire communication, there should be two charts. It can be charts or it can be tables. The tables which you make should be very short, maybe 2 to 3 rows, 2 to 3 columns, not more than that. It should be very, very, very crisp. And make sure whatever table is given in your question paper, you're not just straight away copy pasting that. You have to actually shorten that particular table and use whatever is only required. That is again filtering out of your data. And also the format of your visual aid. You cannot just make any visual representation. You cannot just do any visual representation. That is not clearly explainable to a policyholder, right? Also, if suppose in your data, you have been given a past 20 years of data, and you have to produce bar chart or column chart of that. You cannot use 20 years of data and produce a column chart. That looks very clumsy. That everything is mentioned in your examiner's report. This particular thing over here, you have to again filter out. Maybe you're using past 5 years of data only, and you get your full marks. You do not have to overcomplicate or provide over information to your user. Just 5 years is enough, not including 20 years, right? Yes, Kriti.
To create charts and all, do we get access to Excel in IAI as well?
Yes, you get access to IAI, yes.
Okay.
So again, I'll just clarify it again because they have changed their portal, right? So I'll clarify this again to you. As far as I remember, you get the access. In case of IFO, it's normal you get the access. You have to copy paste that from Excel to Word for sure. But in case of IA, I'll confirm to you. Okay. As far as I remember, you get the access. But yes, in case of CP3, you do not get the MS Word. You get a simple text editor. In IA, you do not get the access to MS Office. MS Word. You get the access to a simple text editor wherein you cannot use those mathematical equations. Actually, those are not required in your paper, but still, you get a simple text editor. You do not get MS Word. So that's there. About Excel, I'll let you know. Okay? Okay. So visual aids are kept simple, very, very simple, so that your audience can understand. Again, if 20 years of information is given, filter out, use just 5 years. Right? Not more than that. Again, it should be well labeled, all the axis, x-axis, y-axis. If you're using two or more data, use proper key or legend, properly titled, everything. And once you explain, once you put a graph, you also have to explain the graph, right? So that should be there. Few common graph which comes in CP3 is pie chart, column chart, line chart is there, but that is very rare. Most commonly you get pie chart and column chart. So these are the three common charts which you get in your CP3 examination. Many times you have to use two charts, right? So that the communication looks good actually. And you get your complete 3 marks there. Overall language, this gives you 7 marks. And here you generally do not get more than 4. So overall language, your tone of writing the entire paper, what is your tone? It is formal or not, whether you're using any emotional tone here, So in this language, the jargons are not counted. Jargons, absence of jargons, again, here you get 4 marks. So overall language is basically the tone of writing. How do you, what words you are using, not using overcomplicated English words, difficult English words, difficult English sentences, idioms, and all of those things, you do not use. You keep it very simple. So generally, I've seen you do not get more than 4 to 5 marks here. That's the maximum you get. Absence of jargon. Again, here 4 on 4. Absolutely, just like charts, here you can score 5 on 5. Here also you can score 4 and 4. How? Do not use any kind of jargon. If you're using it, explain that. And also, if you consider that that particular person is having a good sound knowledge, then obviously you can use these particular jargons. It depends. If you're using more than one jargon, if you're using one jargon, you will lose 1 mark. 2 or more jargons, you lose 2 to 3 marks. That's how it happens in case of jargons. Again, 4 on 4, very easy to score. Do not use superfluous accuracy of numbers. Here, basically, what do I mean? Suppose you're explaining the difference of the difference in profit between 2 years. Do not use decimal places a lot. Either you can just skip using decimal. So if you're writing 1000.33, that is still fine. 33. Do not write 3345. 2 decimal maximum. Or when you're working in millions, then do not at all use the decimal places. That is actually where you lose marks. Again, 3 on 3 is complete gift. You can easily get 3 on 3 here, easily. If you're working in hundreds, 2 decimal, thousands, 2 decimal, millions, do not use any decimal places at all, right? And we, being in a profession of actuarial science, we always have in all our past papers used 4, 5, 6 decimal places. It is actually very difficult for us to, you know, not use decimal places. Why I'm saying this, it actually is very simple to hear, but very difficult to do because you are in habit of using a lot of decimal places. But when you sit down and write CP3, you do not have to use it. Just keep it in mind, you get your 3 marks here. Irrelevant points, again, in this irrelevant points, you do not actually always score 3 marks here. You generally score it between 2 to 2 marks maximum here. Irrelevant points, points which the audience does not bother about. Audience is just bother about 3 to 4 brief ideas. And if you are putting into a lot of extra excess irrelevant information, you will lose points or marks over there. Yes, ma'am.
So do we require any kind of further calculation in this particular exam?
So there have been a few papers in past where a little bit of calculation is required, not a lot. A little bit meaning maybe a percentage you are calculating, premium is given to you, okay, and maybe profit. So a little bit of percentage calculation, or if any calculation is required, they will give you the method. Okay. Or maybe they have calculated something for you, like BMI. They have calculated BMI index entirely and you have to maybe explain it, or you may not have to, depending upon the audience. And actually, that is the difficult part, whether you have to use that calculation or not. And if you actually have to use that, how to explain it into an easy terms.
Okay.
So generally, no, you do not have to do your own research, as I mentioned, and you do not actually have to, you know, do a lot of calculations. But yes, graph, using graphs is entirely up to you, which graph you are using and what graph you will use and what numericals or what information you will use to put into graph. That is something which I believe is very difficult. This 5 marks is both easy and difficult to score. If you just get that point that what I will use in my graph, what numericals I will use in my graph, you are there. But some of us generally get confused during the exam that what should I put? Like if you, when you solve last term's paper, April 2021's paper, they have given a lot of information, a lot of information. Similarly, in September 2020, they have given an entire spreadsheet of information. So in that cases, it became a lot difficult with the students to understand what graph I have to make. Right. Again, it will depend upon the communication. 3 to 4 objectives which we have, on the basis of that, you have to construct the graph. No grammatical error, spelling, punctuation. Again, this 3 marks is very simple because considering we are writing in MS Word, all those red lines, green lines automatically comes in. So you do not generally make this mistake. Again, 3 marks, you somewhere or the other end up making any, not spelling error, but maybe a grammatical error, and you lose maybe 1 mark there. So not 3 on 3, I will not say 3 on 3, but yeah, you can score two over here. And what happens in CP3, in case of IFO, there are two examiners correcting your paper. And I've seen in this 12 marks, especially one examiner giving you 10 marks, 11 marks, one examiner giving you 7 to 8 marks. So that brings down your average. I've seen this. It happened with me as well. So that actually brings down your total average. So you cannot challenge that. It's upon examiner. It's a very subjective paper. It's up to them what they are trying to give you. Then offer to help mentioned at the end. So when we solve the paper, at the end of the paper, you actually have to mention this particular line that if you want any further clarity, any further information, you may contact me on this particular mail, this particular mobile number, whatever. This line gives you 1 mark sure shot. So this is again a gift. 1 mark sure shot. Content, 39 marks. This is the place where it is very, very, very difficult to score. Content, what content you choose to write can be completely different, not completely different, but different with that of, you know, examiner's sample, or maybe what examiner is expecting from you, right? So that is, again, this 39 marks. Around, I've seen many people scoring, most of the people scoring around 25, right? Some of them who are very great at it, they score more than 30, but there are very few of them. So this 39 marks is something you cannot, you know, do anything about this. Yes, obviously, when you practice a lot of papers, you will understand the concept of 3 to 4 objectives, then filtering out the information, everything is there. But still, you will not be able to score more than 25, 27, 28 here. It's very difficult to score. So here, you can just think of scoring 25, like in the worst case scenario. But obviously, if you're practicing a lot, it's easy to score 29, 28 here. If you practice, your content is to the mark, right? Meeting objectives, again, 5 marks. So here, basically, they have a lot of parameters over here. You are meeting the parameter, you're meeting the objective of the audience. So the marking bands are 3 to 5 marks, 2 to 3 marks, 0 to 1 mark. That is how they mark you. Generally, you get between 3 to 5 marks here. If you are actually able to make out the 3 to 4 objectives and actually able to produce it, and if you're not able to make out those 3 to 5 objectives which the audience is asking for, obviously you will get just 2 to 3 marks here. So again, not a very good part of scoring. Reflective questions, as I've mentioned here, most of us, we ignore this portion. We take it for granted that likh lenge isko, kar lenge, ye to ho jayega. That is a general notion which we have, and those are the people who just score 4 to 5 marks in this question. But if you actually give time to these questions, if you study these well, you can easily score 7 to 8 marks here. Correct? So if I just quickly give a recap, 5 mark very easily, 3 marks very easily. You get this 8 marks very easily. Out of this 12, easily you can score 10 marks. This, everything is there. The logical order of points is the place where you generally lose the marks. So 8 to 10, easily you can score. 5 on 5, easily you can score. But again, not all of us are able to do it. So maybe around 3 marks. But yes, 5 marks is very easy to score here. Overall language, again, 4 to 5 marks. Absence of jargon, 4 on 4. Aram se you can get. Superfluous accuracy of numbers, 3 on 3. Like, you can just close your eyes and get 3 on 3 in this. Irrelevant points, here generally we lose 1 or 2 marks, so leave that. No grammatical errors, spelling, punctuation, again 1 or 2 marks we get here. 2 marks, generally it's easily, you can score 2 marks because you're writing in MS Word, so you'll obviously not make any such kind of mistakes. 1 on 1, for sure, offer to help, any help which you're providing. Content, again, 28, 27, you can score. 30, you can score, trust me, you can score 30, 32, I've seen people scoring that. But again, you have to actually practice 10 papers, writing 10 papers, then you can easily score 30 marks here. Meeting objectives, again, it's a very subjective place. And if examiner is not in good mood, they might give you 3 marks here. They will not give you 5, I have never seen anyone getting 5 on 5 here. Even if you are meeting objective, they will cut the point here. They will not give you 5 on 5 ever in this question. So reflective questions, 10 marks, again, you will get in the range of 7 to 8. If you have actually practiced, you can get 9 as well. 10 on 10, never. Right? So this is how you can expect yourself scoring around 60, above 60 marks, if you prepare like this, in this particular manner. Above 70 marks, if you prepare in this particular manner. Generally, passing marks is around 60 for IFOA. Last time, I think it was 59, April term. Prior to that, I think it was around 55 marks. 55 to 57 marks it was around. So it is more or less in the band of 55 to 60 for IFOA. IEI, they never release the passing marks. So you can consider it to be 60. So 60, if I consider passing marks, you can score 70. If you do follow all of these, and obviously if you practice a lot, and it's inborn that you're very good, you will easily score. I've seen people scoring 78, 79, 80 in CP3. I've seen people scoring that. I've also seen a lot of people scoring 63, 65, 64, and just passing the paper. I've also seen a lot of people scoring 57, 58, and just failing because of 2 to 3 marks. I've seen all of these, people post it on LinkedIn and everywhere. So follow this pattern, keep this particular sheet handy all the time. And you just follow this thing. And we'll solve actually in class one by one. And we'll see how to focus on all of these points, like this 12 marks, this 39 marks. How can we improve this? Because these other things you can easily score. 12 marks, getting 39, more than 30 out of 39, getting above 10 in this, getting good marks in the 7-marker question. These are the, and this 10 marks. So these are a few 4-5 places which we'll mainly focus on in our coming classes. This is again a communication checklist, which we'll talk about in later classes. So this was all about CP3. Two things I will just say. You have to practice in this paper, and people who say that, you don't have to practice, just go through 1 or 2 papers, they are wrong. You will never clear in one attempt if you, do that kind of thing. You have to actually sit down and practice. In case of IFOA, syllabus was different. The paper pattern was different in 2016. So if you consider from 2017, you have 2017, 2 terms, 18, 19, 20. So 8 papers there, and 2021, 1 term. So 9-term papers for IFOA. For IEI, I'm not sure about that because they do not, I don't think they do not, they haven't released papers of more than, I think, 5-6 terms. So you will just approximately get 5 to 6 terms in IEI. If you are appearing from IEI, you will first solve all the papers of IFOA, which is your 9 papers. Then you will have to for sure solve minimum of 5 to 6 papers of IEI. If you're appearing from IEI, if you're appearing from IFOA, then you can just stick to IFOA. Do not solve IEI papers. No point. Seriously, no point in solving IEI papers. Just stick to IFOA papers. There is one specimen paper which we'll discuss in class also that you can solve. And we'll have mock papers at the end, 3 mock papers. So all in all, 9 plus 1, 10 papers here. And then 3 mocks. 13 papers, sure, you have to solve if you're appearing from IFOA. If you're appearing from IEI, extra 5-6 papers you have to solve for sure. Because the only difference in IEI, you do not get the scenario material prior. You get on the very same time, right? So you have to actually find out time for reading that scenario separately. In case of IFOA, you have read the scenario, so you do not have to read it again during the exam time. So that's a very big advantage in case of IFOA. In case of IEI, you have to be really quick in reading the paper, understanding the paper, and then producing it, right? So that's there. That's the basic discussion outline, everything which I wanted to discuss about in CP3 basics. And then in coming classes, obviously, we'll be solving and we'll be discussing all of these questions a lot. And we'll be also sharing each other's papers so that we learn from each other's mistakes. And we actually are a better critic of other papers, right? So it actually helps. And if you can do this, you can write a paper and show it to your friend who is not from actuarial background. If that friend can understand your paper, then the policyholder will also be able to understand your paper. So that is how it works, right? So you can do that, but obviously we'll be having a lot of sessions in class as well. So that's not an issue. Any questions you all have to ask? No? So, okay, great meeting all of you. Thank you for joining. Today, this was a heads up. Do not be scared of this paper. Trust me, 50% passing rate of IFOA is really great, actually very great. For CM papers, if you go for CM2, CS2, you had around 33 passing rate, right? So CP3, 50% passing is great, actually very great. But here, just solve these 13 to 14 papers, attend all my classes, and you are done for the paper. You'll easily score very good marks. Okay. Okay. Any more questions? No? Okay. Thank you for joining in. Thank you. You all can leave. Yes.
Thank you.
Yes. Yes, Arpit.
Next class.
One second.